Hello everybody, good evening and welcome to another one of my evening blogs. I'm Cosmic Claire. I can't say nightly evening blogs rightly because even though I do aspire to that, I've just had another couple of days off with severe computer problems which have taken up far more time than I would have liked and left me with a kind of well, I'm sure you know that feeling when you've just been sitting in front of a computer for too many hours in one day and you think, well, I've had enough of that. I haven't got the energy left to do any more, so I'm very sorry. Something somebody said to me yesterday about these kind of topics that I talk about was interesting. He said, well, it's a dog-eat-dog world, isn't it? So all these kind of notions of ethics and spirituality that I talk about, I suppose he was suggesting that they are kind of redundant or merely quixotic at the best. We had quite a long conversation about it, but I suppose, excuse me, I suppose what I'd like to do today is compare different types of ethics and see kind of how they stand in a greater kind of context, because there are kind of several kind of basic different categories of ethics, and you kind of would start out with things like the Ten Commandments, which are kind of practical kind of social rules to prevent strife, and well, other religions have kind of similar kind of things like rules for behaviour and such like. But this kind of develops further into a deeper level when it goes on to the kind of what they call the golden rule, the kind of do as you would be done by, love your neighbour as you would have yourself loved or as you would love yourself. And that kind of comes from a deeper level, because it's not saying what you shouldn't do or just ordering to do things because they're the right things to do, but it's actually saying, well, here are the reasons why they're the right things to do. This is the kind of foundation of those rules. So, you know, because we all know that, you know, rules sometimes have to be bent a little bit, or maybe they aren't applicable to some situations or something like that. Rules can be a bit rigid. And also, if they're rigid or if they're just put down in a particular way, they can be overinterpreted, misinterpreted, and all these kinds of things. So, kind of a rule book is okay so far as it goes as a starting point, but then you have to kind of go on and say, well, why do we have these rules? And then that's kind of that's the golden rule. That's kind of the basis for you know, going on a bit further. And then this comes up against another form of ethics, which I consider to be either literally or metaphorically the work of the devil, because it is so cunning. And this is utilitarianism, the brainchild of John Stuart Mill. And I think he was in the early 19th century. And that's kind of been the foundation of our modern era, the do-as-you-would-be-done-by ethic, which, of course, was, you know, never fully put into practice, but was not, you know, kind of intellectually challenged until, in this way, until John Stuart Mill, which is a kind of atheist philosophy, and it's well, I suppose people will say, "Oh, well, atheism," because I'm not talking about spirituality or God in the sense of conventional, narrow views, the Richard Dawkins view. You have to kind of look a little bit further than that. But it's my belief that we're now moving to the next stage beyond the do as you would be done by, and we've come to the stage where you say, actually, why should you do as you would be done by? And then that goes to the next level, which is, oh, well, everybody is a being of equal and infinite value. And this is the real challenge, I believe, to the complete domination and pandemic of utilitarian thinking in our modern world, which has been slipped in on us. It's like, well, it's for the best of everybody, isn't it? Or rather, not for the best of everybody, for the best of most people, And then you see things like that tragic situation in South America, where the Brazilian government, I believe it is has just I thought they got have got a reprieve on this dam. The indigenous people's got a reprieve on the dam a year or two back, and now it's kind of gone ahead again. It's all this stop start. It's like the letting the Irish people have a referendum against the joining the European treaty or whatever it was, and then when they say no, they come back a year or two later and say, well, come on, we want you to do it, so have another go. And it's like, well, hang on, we said no, or hang on, you said you weren't going to build that dam, and now you come back 2 years later or less than that, and it's like, what's going on, and we kind of got a similar situation here in Leeds, whereby as I've spoken before about this trolleybus thing, which, apart from the serious problems with the actual operation of this thing, which will almost certainly cause more traffic chaos than it's supposed to relieve, and we'll have two, I just read this yesterday or the day before, we'll have massive three coach long articulated trolleybuses on the roads, with carrying as many as 200 people in them. Up to possibly half of those standing, and I thought, this is like kind of cattle trucks, And also, I saw something also recently about how business leaders in Leeds are in favour of the trolleybus. Surprise, surprise! But I bet they won't be using it. They'll be coming in their Daimlers and their Rolls Royces or Jags or Audis or whatever it is that rich people drive these days. And I thought, oh yeah, well, they want all their workers in on time, and they want to make sure that more workers can get in there, and that we can kind of, make this whole Leeds business hub thing, City Square, there we are, where, thousands, tens of thousands probably of people walk through it every day, and it's going to be a new. It's going to be. They want there to be a trolleybus terminus there, or major stop in the middle of City Square, and I'm thinking, the way it's not just treating places like Headingley and Far Headingley and Hyde Park and Woodhouse like they are just irrelevant tools with history and architecture and dare I say, feng shui. And let's get real about this, folks. The proportion and layout of the landscape affects the way people feel, in the way that the proportion and layout of your home affects the way you feel. And knocking down buildings that have been there 200 years, old stone cottages, walls over 150 years old that have got character to them and become part of the perceptual environment and, channeled the lay energies. And interestingly, I mean, this is another one, okay, so, people kind of go, ooh, woo, woo. But it's very interesting that Headingley Hill is reputed to have significant ley lines running along it, and as you may recall, some weeks ago I did a video talking about Sparrow Park at the bottom of the hill, not far from there, where it's let people say, "Oh, that's where all the ley lines meet, isn't it?" And they actually skirt around the kind of the centre of where the old marketplace is, with the two pubs and the church. But it's the way the whole area is just being treated as a means. It's a means. What can they do to it to allow the greater flow through of people from one side to the other? And these people, they just want to get through quicker. So it's like a stampede. You stampede down. You wind the roads. All the people who've got their houses along these roads, psh, they'll lose their nice step back as a long stretch up the Otley Road, where houses are well set back, it's all going to be York Road all over again. Setting aside all these practical considerations, it's the way that the ethical approach that is behind this, because it's being said that the sole criteria on which this will be judged is the apparent saving in time that can be achieved, and this is only speculative because obviously no one's going to be able to know until it happens. So essentially, it's saying that no other conditions or factors are to be taken into account. In other words, it is just a means to an end. And this is one of the things, getting back to those different threads of types of ethical thought that I said at the beginning. This is the final kind of extrapolation of the do as you would be done by ethic, because why? I said before, why should you do as you would be done by? There's the empathy. You might think, oh well, how would that person feel? That person wouldn't feel very well if I took something from them or hurt them. So, I wouldn't feel. I would feel hurt if that happened to me. So I won't do it to that other person. So, what you're doing there is recognizing the value in the other. That the other has value, and there's a famous movie clip going around the internet on YouTube somewhere, where there's this guy shouting, I don't know if it's Albert Finney, it might be someone like that, saying, "I'm a human being, God damn it, my life has value," and it needs to be said. This is why I say that utilitarianism is either literally or metaphorically the work of the devil, because it says, oh well, a few people, well, how many is a few, a few people can be sacrificed for the good of the many. Now that is a very, very dangerous philosophy, and that is what is being propagated by the modern totalitarian financial globalist elite. They're saying, oh yeah, well, we decide that you are expendable, because you don't fit into our equation, and we'll all be a lot happier over here if you just give way, or let us kill you, or take your land, or widen our roads, widen the roads that go near you so we can pass through it. And no, we don't care. And that's what that's what we have. We have the situation where the value of individual human beings is well, it's not equal. Some are, expendable, and some are excluded. And this, I believe, this is probably the precursor to a kind of what's the term? Oh, it's completely slipped my mind. The technocracy of transhumanism. That's the word I'm thinking of. Whereby people will become more and more programmed into android-like cyborgs. This kind of sounds a bit scary in science fiction and X-Files and all this kind of stuff, But actually, we're so on the edge of this. If you pay attention to the science reports. And you can be sure that a lot of this is way ahead of what is being reported openly. There's always secret research going on in the military. Do you think they would let us know what they're doing? Get real. So, this is going way beyond. It's going way beyond humanity, and even if you're a humanist and don't have kind of spiritual beliefs of metaphysical dimensions, I think that's still pretty harmonic with what I'm saying. So, it is about human value, and I think that one of the downsides of utilitarianism, lots of downsides, is they've taught people that they are expendable and that they don't have equal value. So the first thing to do is remember that you have equal value. You are a unique being of the universe. You have absolute infinite value, equal with all other humankind, and you mustn't ever let the elites of any type let you believe or tell you that you are less than they are, because you may be poor, but you are a human being, and God damn it, your life has value. So I'll leave it there, and thank you for watching, and I hope I'll be able to keep coming back nightly from now on. Okay. Thank you for watching. In Lakesh.